हरे कृष्णा महाराज, थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर ज्वाइनिंग टुडे फॉर दिस मॉन्क्स पॉडकास्ट. इट इज अ ग्रेट ऑनर टू होस्ट यू, एंड आई हैव हर्ड योर लेक्चर्स एंड बीन नरिश्ड बाय एस्पेशली योर स्वीट एंड इंसाइटफुल नरेशन ऑफ द लॉर्ड्स पास्ट टाइम्स. बट अलॉन्ग विद दैट, रिसेंटली एस्पेशली लास्ट सेवरल ईयर्स, द ट्राइबल केयर इनिशिएटिव विच यू आर पायनियर्ड is something which has few parallels in our movement. So I thought I wanted to know more about it. I thought we could discuss that today. So can you share how you got inspired to start this initiative, Maharaj?
See, I got inspiration because I saw the mood of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is to special bhakti yoga works better for people that are simple and humble. Then I observed these are the inbuilt qualities among the tribal people. They are organically very simple, because they are from complicated and complex material lifestyle. They maintain a very simple natural life, and they are humble also, because they don't have so much, they are not so rich or so educated to feel very proud. So I thought Mahapurush message is very much befitting message to reach to this tribal people, that most qualified and deserving people. Then when I started bringing this message to them, I could see very interesting way, very simple way, and so deeply they are accepting this. And one more thing I observed also, the tribal youth, thousands of tribal youths are roaming in the forest aimlessly. Then when I started to give them education and teach them spiritual subject matter, I saw they are very receptive, very, very, you say, receptive and very focused. And they memorize verses very quickly.
Really?
Then I realized it because of this, because they're not distracted, the mind is very focused. So many, many nice things then I found. Then I realized the real treasure of India is there in the forest and mountains, not only in the forms of woods, or farms of mines. The real treasure is there hiding in the forest. And the youths are so talented youths. And at the same time, I realized how foolish we are. Other people from abroad, they have come and taken advantage of this innocent, simple and humble tribal people. And we are so foolish, we are sitting idle, and not using the real resources that our country has.
Yes, Maharaj.
So that is how this came up.
Yes, Maharaj. You know, when before I was introduced to Bhakti, my father was like a preacher for the government. You know, he used to go to very remote villages and he used to do public welfare documentaries prepared by the government for awareness of diseases and other things. So at that time, I also used to travel to small villages, and I could see people were very, very simple, what you said over there. So now you have been preaching in, say, I think Orissa, Bengal for more than three decades. So was it some particular incidents that inspired you to start this focus? Or apart from the traditional preaching that we were doing, what specifically triggered this?
So what happened, we have a temple in Jharkhand, Kanai Narsala.
Okay.
Then there are nearby tribal people are there. So some or other came to my mind. I told the temple president that you should preach to tribals. Then he said, but they're all drunkards, they're all hunters. Then I told him, then don't tell him about four regulatory principles. Tell him just to chant Hare Krishna. Oh. Because there is a lot of supporting statements in scriptures for these forest dwellers, tribal people. They, because of their lifestyle and everything, even if they don't follow regulatory principles, when they're chanting holy name, that will work upon them better than we so-called civilized people. I read in one purport. So I told him, don't tell them about no meat eating, no drinking. Just tell them to chant Hare Krishna. That will help. Then he was doing, but then after 2-3 years, when I went there, then he introduced me some tribal people. They're already initiated.
This was which year, Maharaj? Which year was this, roughly?
It was like 7-8 years before.
Okay.
Yes. I started tribal care initiative like 5 years before. So then when I saw, then I said, how they become vegetarian? Yes, Maharaj. They become vegetarian. They have taken initiation. Then I realized the holy name itself preaches to the people. Our preaching is not acting upon people. When somebody just chant Hare Krishna, take the holy name. By the power of holy name, these people are life are changing. Oh. Then I took interest. I thought this is a very important project. We must explore. And we are not exploring this area. This big treasure is there. Then I started working on this in ISKCON Tribal Care Initiative. We had 5 initiatives. Now care initiative, educational care, then health care, social care, emotional care, spiritual care. On different areas. And gradually it is developing and they're very nice people, very easy to approach. Then they easily see, you go to city people, there's so much arguments, this, that. Those people, you tell them to do, they just do it. When you go to some village, there are some village, whole village they buy, not free, you don't give free. They buy Japamala.
Oh, really?
They buy Gita. We don't give free Gita, but we give reduced price. So it is like that. So then gradually these tribal children start to join, become brahmachari. Now we have 2,000 brahmacharis.
How many? How many?
We have about 16-17 brahmacharis.
Okay.
And in Mayapur we have like 6-7 brahmacharis. They are the best book distributors. We have Mayapur Sankirtan. And all by the love, then I thought a very big area that we have ISKCON has not explored.
Okay.
Where other community people 100, 200 years before, and they have come there and they have been working on them. Like that.
Oh, that's true. So Maharaj, what is the culture or the religion of these tribals? Do they worship some devatas or do they worship forest gods? They have their Kuldaivats, or what do they previously worship?
It's a different tribal area. They have different way of worshipping.
Okay, but it doesn't...
Some tribal...
But they can easily take up Krishna Bhakti, their previous forms of worship and Krishna Bhakti don't conflict with each other anytime?
I'm telling you
that
some area they worship little bit. It depends where this tribal is located. Some tribals in deep forest, their culture is different. Some tribals are very close to city area, their culture is different and they're exposed. So some area they worship Shiva, that will be better quality. And some they go Kali, Durga, then some they worship ghosts. Most of them they do Bali, you know, sacrifice, animal sacrifice. And the ghost worship this, that. And some tribals also are there. they don't think they are Hindu. They think we have one religion like this.
Oh.
So different area, different.
What do they call their religion? Or no name?
There's a Santal people. We have Santal religion like this.
Oh, okay.
So like that, they have their own culture, own religion. Each tribal have their own culture, one language, one dress, one faith like that. But the point is, definitely they identify to Hinduism more than any other religion.
Okay.
But other religions, they come, care for them, some other they divert them.
Hmm.
So when we go, it is more easy to reach to these people.
Okay.
Now, interestingly, you should know one thing. In Jharkhand, there's one tribe called Santal.
Okay.
And in that tribe, they have some Guru Babas. They do preach to their people. They worship all demigods, all kinds of things.
Hmm.
But interestingly, lakhs of these tribals, they're all pure vegetarian. No onion, no garlic, no wine, no intoxication. So much strict, they don't eat food cooked by others also. So they are called Safahur. They keep Saf Sutar, they wear white clothes. So it is like Mahapurush Mercy, the ready-made, waiting. So when we go and speak to the Guru Babas, they are very nicely accepting to chant Hare Krishna. Like that.
So were these people Vaishnavas earlier, or how is it that they have such a pure or sattvic culture?
That I have to explore. No, I cannot find what is the root. They have present Guru Baba, and Guru Baba, some Guru Baba, where it started from, it's not hundreds or thousands, lakhs of people. It is so challenging to make people vegetarian. No? And what they speak to them, this is not like one tribe, they're all like that. It's not one tribe like that. Within the tribe, these people, they go and preach individuals. You understand?
Oh.
And make them. So it is very interesting. I don't know what they speak, what they do, how they're able to do it. Some other these people, they have taken very interest, Guru Babas, in Krishna consciousness, chanting, and all other groups are already
playing. In which part? Bengal, or they are in the far?
In Jharkhand. In Jharkhand. Jharkhand. Sahibganj district and some other districts also.
Okay.
That is very interesting.
So Maharaj, technically, how are tribals defined? Are these people living far away from the cities, living in the forests, or is it by their caste or race? Or how is a person called a tribal?
The tribals are mainly those they stay in forest and mountain.
Okay, so they
but
don't...
In due course of time, they have the tribes. They have thousands of tribes in India.
But they don't have any dwelling place, like a common village or something like that. They live scattered in the forests.
They have village, but maybe one village could be like 1 or 2 mile radius, because there's so much free land. They have one house here, one house there, one house here, like this. But call it one village, like 50 houses or 20 houses. Some places, the houses are very close to each other. Some places, they're far from each other, like that. Then what happens, in due course of time, when jungles are cut, many ministers also are there from tribal background. So even if they're educated, but they will be identified as tribal, like that. Civil caste and civil tribe.
Okay. So it's more based on, you could say, birth, that certain people are called tribals.
Yes, by birth the tribals, and among tribals they have different tribes.
Okay.
Santal, Munda, Riang, Kargi, Bhel tribes, like this, thousands of groups are there.
Okay. And so we are doing tribal care in which all parts? I saw on your website you are doing in many, many parts of that part of the country, isn't it? Which all places currently we are doing?
We are now mainly doing we, our presence is there in Tripura, Assam, Nagaland little bit, then Jharkhanda, Bengal, Orissa, Andhra, then some area in Maharashtra also, from Wada farm they are doing, and also Talsari they are doing. Then we have Gujarat, some places like that.
Oh, so is all this centralized, or is it that different centers are just doing on their own, broadly speaking?
No, up to now, like your Wada farm, they are doing, Gauranga doing whatever, whoever he introduced, we had a meeting yesterday.
Okay.
They're doing there. Some area maybe they're doing another one, but from our tribal care ministry, we are directly doing this Assam, Tripura, Jharkhand, Andhra like this. And we are encouraging all other centers so we can come in one group, so that it will be nice, so that our activities can be magnified, we can help each other to this tribal area, done like that.
Okay. So Maharaj, sometimes some of the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, they are often quite anti-Hindu, because they feel that in the past we have been exploited, and so do you experience that sentiment, or these tribes are not like that, these tribes are not so much like that?
Till today I have not faced any people that they are become very angry upon Hindus or Brahmanas because they look them down. But it is fact, Hindus and Brahmanas, they look them down, they don't care for them, and they consider untouchables. Maybe they are not mentioning to me, to us, because we are going, we are very caring, sitting, this, that. But it is true that they have been deprived, or they have been treated, I'll say, not nicely, or in a caring mood.
Oh.
But I don't know, at least, I don't know, in Assam, Tripura, I don't see that they have become very antagonistic. Maybe it could be Madhya Pradesh, or Uttar Pradesh, or Dalit, this, that, all this concept is very prominent. Brahmana groups are very prominent. But Bengal, Assam, Tripura, it is not like that. They have not been mistreated by Brahmanas or mistreated by Hindus. It is not like that. Though some area like it, like Tripura, always Bengali tribals, they have conflict. But Tripura whole state was tribal only. Then Bengal infiltrated inside, then that became more prominent. So because of that, otherwise, caste-wise, I don't think they are very much against Hindus or Brahmanas like that.
Oh, okay. That's interesting. One thing which I have noticed in our movement is that if somebody becomes a serious devotee, then their background really doesn't matter much. You know, somebody is a dedicated devotee, they become empowered, they get the facilities, and they can do outreach. So they will also be finding it comfortable in our movement, because there is no discrimination, they are cared for. That is quite positive. So have you, when you bring, I saw notice on your website that you get all these tribals to come together once a year on Ram Navami to Mayapur. So when you bring them to Mayapur, how do the general people over there see them? Are they welcomed positively by the people in Mayapur, or is it that they are treated like lower class people? Means, is caste discrimination still an active presence?
Mayapur ISKCON devotees?
Not Mayapur ISKCON devotees, but in general, in I know devotees don't discriminate.
No, when this our conversion takes place, in our ISKCON, there is no lower caste, higher caste.
Yes, of course, that is. So they feel a sense of belonging over here. Yes, Maharaj. And
When the tribal convention takes place, when our devotees see, when tribal, when devotees see these tribal people, so simple, so humble, so nice, they're all moved. Instead of becoming, looking them down, they become very affectionate towards them. They get lot of love and affection from ISKCON devotees and from everybody. So my point is, Hindus also, a lot of Hindus not developing very much loving attitude towards them. So they feel very happy when they come for this tribal convention.
Oh, amazing. You mentioned that you are offering them the tribal holistic care. You're probably providing health support, educational support, and various apart from spiritual support. So is all this supported by the government also? Because all this will require a lot of resources, financial, human, infrastructural. So how do we get all these resources to provide this tribal care?
Well, government has thousands of crores budget for tribal care. And because Hindus are not so much interested, so the crores, thousands of crores been channelized to Christian institution. And whether for in the interest of government or whatever it is, so Christian people have taken advantage of it. And hundreds of big hostels, school, hospitals they have built with government money. But the impression is given Christians are helping, but actually government giving that. And that is one way. And another thing is a lot of budget government has, and in between people are eating all that money also.
Yes.
It's not reaching to the people there. That is second thing. And last thing is we don't get a single penny help from government. Very helpless situation. So last 4-5 years we have been trying. Ministers are involved, but they cannot manage for us 1 paisa even if from the thousands of crores. So we are just begging from our devotees and we are helping to the tribal. That is present situation. Oh. Neither state money nor government help. Not anything. Like I travel, go to temple, I go to UK, America, different places, I explain to devotees. Then whatever I get with that, I have built 10 schools. Now government gave us 20 schools to run, but they can't run. Then we have more than 100 parsalas, about 5,000 children studying. We have many community centers, we have built many clean drinking water project. So things are happening like that.
Oh. So how is it if the government is secular, you know, if they are supporting Christians, how can they not support us? Or is it that the Christians have more credibility established because of what they have done in the past? Because that would be discouraging.
They have more credibility, and also see, to get money from government, you have to know the channel.
Oh, okay.
So we don't have that channel to this government, even and the government is so bureaucratic are there. And maybe I'm not sure, maybe when you want to get some government funding, you have to spend some money here and there, pocket money you have to put.
Okay.
Maybe we are not so expert in doing that.
Yes.
Maybe they are thinking they're taking from others, from sadhu. They can take from us. And they don't give us also. That could be another reason also.
Oh, okay. That's amazing, isn't it, to actually generate all the financial resources for doing this. That's very resourceful. So normally, if the Christians use government funds, then can they actually convert people to Christianity if they're doing that? Or they, when the tribals get supported by Christians, I mean, do the Christians convert them directly, or it is more discreet?
Christians, whatever social welfare activities they do, they are very particular about giving them their knowledge of the religion. That is fast. They don't leave any effort. They don't keep aside any effort. Any help they do to anybody, that must follow the teachings of Bible. So So that agenda is there. But they do it, they don't have to do it actively. They are doing openly. But interesting, they are not challenged by anybody. Our government doesn't challenge. And Hindus are happy people. They are having happy time. Okay, you do whatever you want, we do whatever you want. And that is like this, you know.
Really? So they, in a sense, they are using government funds to promote their religion.
Yes, definitely. And what government fund? Government means that is all taxed up Hindus. Hindus' money is used for spreading Christianity. Government getting tax from Hindus and penalizing to tribal. That's what happened.
Oh.
And I don't accuse Christian people because we people are lazy. What government will do? Our Hindu people are sitting idle. We have no mechanism to get money from government and spend it for tribal people. It was so obvious. You see our Hindu groups, apart from our ISKCON, there are so many other societies, big kathakars, big things happening, all in big cities. Nobody takes trouble to go there. Christians, 100 years before, 150, they have taken the trouble to go there. As a result, the whole state is now become Christian now.
Which
Nagaland, Mizoram, all those 19%, 95% are all Christian. Three states, fully Christian.
95%? Nagaland, Mizoram, and which one?
One more. Okay. One more state. In that side. Manipur, Mizoram, Nagaland, Mizoram, one more.
Okay.
Yes.
And so then when they become Christian, do they become hostile to Hinduism or they are only nominally Christian because Christians have offered them some support or something like that?
See, all kinds of people are there. Okay. Some people, just for money's sake, they become Christian. Then some people, after become Christian, they become very cutter Christian. They become hostile. We don't face the... towards us, nobody has behaved badly.
Okay.
We maintain relationship with Christians and everybody because we don't go against them. But there are varieties of people. Some people are cutter Christian. Some people are because of getting help by name they are Christians. Some people they become Christians now they don't get any help, so they are not happy with Christians like this. Okay. All varieties of people are there.
That's true. And the Christian missionaries who come there, are they Indians or are they non-Indians? Those who preach to them?
The main people, they come from Europe, America, different places. But most of the people are from Kerala and Tamil Nadu. All the fathers Eastern India, Northeast, mainly from Kerala and Tamil Nadu.
Interesting. So they get trained, they get recruited over there, trained, and then they come and do service here. Okay.
Yes. They have one gesture project. I told you that day. Did you go to the site? They have a gesture project.
Yes, I saw that.
$50 billion. They have big college to train people how to convert. They have different mechanism how to convert only. They train thousands of youths are getting trained up. Now recently one article came that somebody said they have a target of 10 crore people they want to convert to Christianity. So these are all open things. There's nothing secretly happening.
10 crore they want to convert?
Yeah, they have a plan. I'll send you that link to you. I send it here. I put it in ICC. Some very big personality telling about that project.
Oh, amazing. 10 crore is almost, it's a very large number. So in how many years they want to do this?
The detail I have not seen, but the point is where they convert. They don't convert in Europe or America or Russia. They cannot convert in Arabic countries.
Yeah, Africa and India.
Africa is only converted. Because they are all converted either Muslim or Christian. They are mainly Bangladesh, nothing much. They are being mainly India and Nepal. Nepal, they are big target for converting, and India.
Oh, okay. No, when I was in America, I was at some interfaith conferences, and many times among Christians there, they consider it actually as a very noble and noble activity of great sacrifice to go to India, and they don't say we are converting, but we are going on missionary work. And what they say is that these people are poor, they are deprived, and we are uplifting their lives. So they often portray it more as humanitarian than religious. But it seems they always bring together the two, humanitarian and religious together. Isn't it?
It is not, it seems. It is so obvious. It's like Bhagavad, Pashtati, Tapashtati. We are like old. Nah. It's so obvious. They're rampantly, they're increasing their numbers. It's so clear. Still, if they say we are going to uplift them and we believe it, are we pretend like we are believing this, then there's nobody else more police than us. The whole state has become Christian. What is happening in Kerala? What is happening in Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh also? Situation is very miserable there.
But you are saying that we have not faced any conflicts. So now we are also doing a significant amount of tribal care. So don't the Christians feel threatened that we are actually taking the tribals toward us and they will not be available? Or there are many, many tribals, so they don't bother so much?
We are not reaching to the Christian. They are not challenged. And we are reaching only to Hindus. And we are too small in front of them. We are like they are like ocean. We are like one cup of water. Nah.
Oh, really?
So they will feel challenged in future. If you can do something substantial, they may feel challenged. So, but sometimes our tribal caregiver, they get little hard time. They report to me.
Okay.
Some Christian youth, they give a little hard time. They need police protection, this, that. But not so gross way. We have faced any trouble like that. And we are trying to move forward in such a way that we have no confrontation with Christian people. Because many people, they ask me, Maharaj, you are going to tribal, are you converting Christians to Hindu? So my answer to them is, first, let us make Hindus proper Hindu.
Okay.
Hindus are not the Hindu, why are we after the Christians? Let us take care of the Hindus first. There are thousands of tribals not converted to Christianity, let us take care of them. Why you go up to Ghar Vapsi? Those there in the Ghar, we are not taking care of them. And we are running behind the others. No, come back to the house, come back to the house. You understand my point?
Yes, yes, okay.
Yeah, are you taking care of those tribals? They are already not converted. That we are not doing.
Okay.
And we are after bringing the others back to Hinduism. Good, but first let us take care of it. That's why I told the conversion will stop within 7 days. All we have to stand by these people who are not yet converted. Just by our presence, conversion will stop.
Okay.
They are very helplessly there, nobody to help them. And nobody goes to those far distant mountain forest, like 10, 20 kilometers inside the forest, 40 kilometers inside the forest. So that become a paradise for other community people to spread the gospel, because there is no challenge over there. No competitor, no challenge. So and our Hindu organizations are not interested like that.
Oh, okay.
So ISKCON, we started this, and I hope ISKCON people will take interest. If ISKCON can put 5% of that energy, and the resources, what manpower, what money power we have, 5%, then we can achieve so much. But in this community, the challenge also, now people are busy with their own project, own things, everybody, they don't take it so seriously. Like that.
Yes, Maharaj. So when you say that we don't confront Christians, that's because we don't reach to the people whom they are reaching. We have other people to reach out to. That's why we are. That's how confrontations are being avoided.
Yeah, we openly we don't reach to their community, but when you do program for distribution, Christian people they come, they take prasad, and also many places when we do program, we invite the VIPs. They are from Christian background. The MLA or district magistrate or Anchal Pradhan, they are from Christian background. We do some school opening, we bring them also. So like that.
So they come, they don't mind coming?
No, no, yeah. They come, they're very nice. They come, they're very courteous. In your school, you have Christian children. In your hostel, you have Christian children also. And school or Christian children come with Tilak also. Oh, we have example like that. It's like that.
Oh, okay. So when we say run these schools or other, we could say humanitarian initiatives, are all of these run by devotees or they're mainly managed by us and there are other people who are taking care of it?
Initially, we started with our devotees. Then now in due course of time, many tribal people, they have taken initiation also. They have become devotees.
Okay.
There, and we don't have any karmic people as such. We have mostly devotion devotees or some devotional minded people like that.
Oh, okay.
We don't hire people like karmic people so much, engaging them. Not like we don't have that much resource.
Oh, okay. And in these schools, we teach the normal syllabus and we also teach some bhakti, or how much freedom do we have to teach in these schools?
See, we teach them normal syllabus, government curriculum, but we teach them something bhakti. The point is, there is ample opportunity to teach them bhakti, because what we teach them in the forest, nobody is there to challenge. The problem is, where is the teacher? We don't have people to go to the school from our eastern side, guide them, the children, teach them the bhakti. We don't have that. Because all our people are busy in the city. You understand the point? But where the Christian people, they fly from Europe, they fly from America, spend 50 months, high good background people, they stay with tribal, teach to them. But in our case, it is, up to now it has not happened. I don't see any good family people, they want to go to the forest, give their love and care, see to them. We don't see from our congregation like that, except they just give 2,000 donations. Up to now, they give some donations, that's all.
Okay. So Maharaj, till now, how many tribals have we been able to reach? And how many have, say, become initiated, or is there some track record of that?
Well, we don't have, I know how many states, but we have a record of how many villages. Yesterday, we have a meeting, a tribal care committee, national committee. Gauranga Prabhu is part of that also. So we told our tribal care office to make a survey, find out exactly how many villages we have covered. Our individual tribal caregivers, they know everything, but we just have to put it together.
Okay. But roughly it will be how much? Means in thousands or in tens of thousands, or how much would it be? Roughly?
Roughly, village will be, how many? Not many. We'll have about 300 villages maximum they're covering.
And that means how many people roughly?
300 villages, 400 villages. Then if average you take 100 families, how much is that?
100 families means 3-4 people in one family?
Yes, 100 family, an average 100 family per village, 400 village means how much family coming?
Okay, that's 40,000.
40,000 families.
That means about 16,000 people, we could say.
Yes. Means we have link, we have relationship with them.
Okay.
And I'll say those that are in relationship with us, there's no question they will get converted to other religion. There's no question.
Oh.
Irrespective of how much we're helping them. Because of our presence only. that they will not feel inclined to go other community, and other community people will not dare to enter into that village also.
Oh, okay, interesting. And usually when we have the festival at Ram Navami, how many people are able to come to Mayapur?
We get maxed out 1800, 2000 like.
Oh, that's it. And all this has happened in the last just 4 or 5 years?
Yeah, 4 years.
Yeah, so that's amazing. In just 5 years, it's a significant number of people who have been reached. And
I will not say it's significant because of our limited resources, number is like this. If you have more devotee, more money, it could be 100 times more. Okay. It is like that. Wherever you go, you get results, response there. Wherever you go, any village we go, make our presence, then we get immediate results from the people, response and results. It is a matter of gathering more resources, manpower, things like that.
Okay. It's amazing. So Maharaj, traditionally in our movement, there has been some concern that we shouldn't get too much into humanitarian activities. So sometimes when we do Food for Life or we start a hospital, there has been some criticism. But at the same time, we cannot just care for the soul and say we will not care for the body. So how do you deal with this challenge? Because you're also doing humanitarian out care, but then you're also giving spiritual. So how do you balance that?
I saw somewhere, I forgot to save that quote, Prabhupada saying, unless you feed people, if they're hungry, they will not accept your religion. Prabhupada says that.
Yes, I've seen that quote, yes.
You have seen that. Please send it to me, I can save it. So that's why it is not humanitarian exactly. See, when you take care of the soul, you have to take care of the body. At least in this people's case. And one thing I have observed, I have been doing school, water, this, that, very nice. They like, because of COVID-19, we did hundreds of villages of free prasad distribution. Thousands of people, I got a very good donation. And I saw people are much more happy eating prasadam than opening school, college, hospitals. Instant happiness. Yeah. And I was thinking that Prabhupada has the best way. That he has given us, you distribute prasadam only. So that's why I'm encouraging our tribal caregivers that whatever school, college you are doing, we'll do it. But now you give more importance, go village to village, give them prasadam. And that big smile in their face, that is pure prasad distribution, you know. So that is very good result.
Yes,
and our humanitarian work is nothing in comparison to what the others are doing. You are very negligible.
Oh, okay. So I think the fear of some devotees is that if we get too much into humanitarian work, then our spiritual outreach may get lost. But you are able to do both in parallel. So it's not a risk, isn't it?
No, what are devotees thinking, that is correct. Because if you go for preaching Krishna consciousness, you don't get much importance, you don't get much donation. You go for humanitarian, then people love you, they like you, they praise you, a lot of donation comes. As a result, our attention goes more on that than the devotional thing. And that is what has happened to other society also. But in our case, we have an agenda behind this. Every village we go, we have a target to reach. We have a school and we have a... See, the other society, they are using humanitarian and dharma, like a pinch of dharma is there, touch of dharma. A religious or spiritual. They give it spiritual, like Ramakrishna Mission, Bharatamashrama Sangha. The school, material education first, and then just little prayer, this, that. No. Ramakrishna Mission, all the schools are there. Tribal children are studying. But they don't have a target like Christians. No. But we have a target like Christians. Do you want to now bring, give them much more than this thing? So our goal is different. So there is no question, we will be distracted. Because we are double community. Like I have not three, I have double three community. In one village, 40 deep forest, there are 40 families. Out of which 9 families have taken initiation. 12 families have become vegetarian. They are doing agriculture farming with small scale. So our goal is different, no? We are not end our business doing some hospital or some school like that. We want to get result out of it. So I hope it will not divert us too much. Yes. That time.
So if I understand right, what you are saying is, in many other Hindu organizations, they don't have much spirituality anyway. So then humanitarianism is what is the most focus. In our case, spirituality is quite prominent. Our practices, our philosophy. So naturally that emphasis will come out in when we go out also. Yes, Maharaj. And when we do all these programs, when we go to the tribal, do we like make some namahattas or what do we do over there? Or is it in the schools itself we have the programs or in people's homes? Or how do the programs happen there?
We don't call it namahatta. We open tribal care center.
Okay.
And different villages, we build community centers. There they do patta, they gather once a week, they do some festival like that. Then we have some area which is very conducive, get good help. We develop a project just like in Bengal, Purulia, there's a place called Ajodhya Hill. We called it Janakastuta Project. Janakastuta Project, school, hostel, vocational training centers, main place, then surrounding 50-60 villages, they cater from there. Same way in Hailakandi district, we have also two main centers, one Nilagiri Project, another Nilachala Project. So here we have base, we have temple, we have devotees, we have school, and from there they go village to village. And Tripura also we have like that. So organically this is coming up gradually.
Oh, okay. So we don't have to in any way curtail ourselves. So devotees can go in saffron, wear tilak, do harinam, conduct festivals. We don't have to in any way hide our bhakti. Do we have to do that in any way?
We go as a devotee, not so.
Oh, okay.
Positive.
That's wonderful. And Maharaj, so this is quite wonderful hearing about tribal care. Hey, can you also speak something about the outreach in Mayapur and Bengal apart from the tribal care? Because we also are, our international headquarters in Mayapur, and then I heard that the outreach in Bengal is also going on in a very big way. So how are things going on there?
Well, for Mayapur, our biggest outreach is Namahatta. Thousands of Namahatta centers. And they have a very big number of followers. Then last 20 years, we have started this Gita correspondence for that also now. Thousands of people joining, doing full Gita correspondence course. Attending convention, exams, getting certificates. Then my surrounding village, we have local teaching programs also. Like different things are there.
Oh, okay. And how do you see the Ibn Star Mayapur temple comes up? Do you see that will affect our preaching itself in a big way? Or our preaching will depend more on our Namhatta and other initiatives?
When Mayapur temple opens, that will enhance our preaching. But through Namahatta, we are making our foothold in the village. Our presence is there. When big temple will come, people will come, become very surprised, very happy, will add flavor to it. But first, we have to make our foothold in every village. Okay. Now, that is very important. Like in Bombay, thousands of people are coming. But we have to reach in Maharashtra every village. Then you have thousands of followers.
Hmm.
Like that. Yes. Both has to be done side by side. We have to make effort in the field, then we have to make the temple, they'll come and see. Like that.
Okay, yes, Maharaj. Then the temples will become not just like tourist places for visiting, but they will be like spiritual nourishing places for people who have already been connected. Yes, Maharaj.
Yes, the Mayapur whole infrastructure is used to so much seminars going on, so many training and big Namahata building, Gita course building, MI, and so much courses going on. That means people are getting all training, seminars, training, like that. Yes. Our ISKCON is not people come and like not like any Hindu temple, people come, take darshan, do little puja, give little dakshina and go. It is not like that.
Yes.
Anybody comes and see, and they will get really groomed lessons before they leave. So yes. Many ways.
Like, yes, Maharaj. Maharaj, you have also been quite prolific in writing books. So which books are you currently writing on?
I have now two books just recently editing going on. One is Sri Mandir, which describes everything about the Jagannath temple inside. And another is Narasingha appearance.
Other is?
Narasimhadeva's appearance. Everything about Lord Narasimhadeva.
Ugra Narasimha in Mayapur? Or which Narasimha?
Not about Mayapur, about general Narasimha.
Oh, okay. Narasimhadeva appearance.
Okay. Lord Narasimha.
Oh, okay. Wonderful. Maharaj, has been very informative and inspiring to hear about how this initiative has taken off. And I will put the information about the websites also below the YouTube description. And devotees can visit. And those devotees who want to support, they can also support through online. And is there any concluding words you would like to speak, Maharaj?
All this main support we want. This news should spread that ISKCON is working on tribal people, helping them. That is first thing, then this news spreading. And second is the, wherever devotees they are, everywhere they have tribal people. Instead of giving us financial help, more important is if they can help tribal people there and communicate with us. Okay, we have tribal people here. 20, 30, 40 villages, give some guidance, we'll take care of the tribal. We don't need money from them. Take care of the tribal. If they want, I can give money to them. They want to money, books, this, that. I want now man more than the money.
Oh, okay. Yeah. That's amazing. Yes, Maharaj. Thank you very much for your time and attention, time and your sharing your wisdom and your experiences. Humble obeisance. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hare Krishna.